Hello, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls of all ages. Welcome to this edition of the RV Van Wagon. Don't know, I am an event producer. I produce events on many different levels. Some of them have to do with like your weddings and things like that. I also do, as you guys know, karaoke shows. Maybe you don't know, if you look at my channel, I do huge Halloween events and other types of public events. And what I'm talking to you about today is what I believe they're calling VanStock. And I've heard a few rumors about it, and in the rumors it sounds like you guys don't know what you're doing so much as far as putting together a public event. And I could tell you a lot of things about that. The first thing you're going to want to consider when you put together events that involve public and a large amount of people is you want to have a business organization, like an LLC. So that's kind of one of the first things you want to do, is get yourself established as a business. The second thing you want to do is get yourself a location that's legal to support such an event. And this is an occupancy event you guys are talking about. So whatever property you're on has to be legally supportive of a public occupancy event. All right, just so you guys know. The other thing is, there's certain tasks you're going to have to do to support that event. One of those, probably, most likely, is going to be electrical distribution. Now, when you're doing electrical distribution, which in most cases you're going to have to do, it has to be up to certain code. I'm not going to go into depth about how electrical can be distributed throughout your event, but I'm just saying that there are major guidelines that you have to follow when putting power or even just running lights for nighttime use in public events. I've heard a lot of concerns, or at least a couple concerns, about the insurance. Really, the insurance isn't that big of a deal. I would suggest starting bottom line, a $2 million liability insurance, and you're going to want to also cover the person who owns the property. You want to list them as additionally insured. You most likely are going to have to list the county or the city that you're involved in as additionally insured. And so there's certain things that you'll have to do with your insurance to make sure that everybody is covered in and outside of the event. Okay, it's up to you guys to make sure everybody's covered. If you're talking about having alcohol on property, there's huge laws that pertain to alcohol and consumption on property and distribution of alcohol. So obviously, if you're going to be a distributor of alcohol providing it, you're going to need to have an alcohol license or have a vendor that has an alcohol license for wherever you guys are deciding to put this event on. If you're not selling alcohol and you're just having people drink on site, well, you're completely liable for all the people that are drinking on your site, okay? You're liable for minors drinking. All those things, if they're on your property during your event, you're going to be liable for those types of things. So at my events, I scan for that at the gate. I don't allow, if they're visibly intoxicated, to come in and participate in the event, which for you van guys might put a hamper on things, okay? Alcohol is a big liability at your event, so just be careful of that. You're going to need security there, not just, you know, your buddy. You're going to need real security from a trained and certified security facility that can handle your event legally, all right, and can deal with any problems without you having to deal with them. There's a lot of fire laws that are going to pertain to having vehicles close together that have fuel in them. All right, if you're talking about having a campground situation, you want to make sure you check in to those fire laws, open air fires like campfires and anything like that, you have to deal with up front, get the facts, know what you have to have for fire safety before you ever go into it. Fire safety is a huge concern. Fire safety could be a big, big problem for you, all right? Or maybe not. You would probably want to have an EMT on site in case anything goes wrong. And an EMT also has a first aid station. So you want to have that in place as far as your planning goes. If you're doing any kind of food at all, depending on where you're at, you want to make sure that your food handlers have permits to handle food and that everybody has permits with the health department to sell and provide food at your event, okay? There may or may not be fees involved with getting the permits, but I know that you must check with your local health organization, city health regulators, to make sure that you're on board with the health certificates needed to properly serve food. And that is even wrapped food, like ice cream and candy bars. Make sure you guys are cool on that. Facility associates, you're gonna need enough staff to make sure that everybody is well taken care of at the event as far as safety and as far as logistics go. So you really have to think about that one, guys. Who's gonna be needed where? And this goes all the way down to the guy with the flashlight parking rigs at night. And all it takes is for one rig to hit another rig, and that could mess up your event in some fashion. So don't let that happen. Keep control of the event. Auxiliary vendors at the event. Maybe you want to have some people there selling food or selling their wares. Whatever it is they're selling at your event, you need to be in control of it by as far as knowing that they are permitted to do that type of thing at your event, knowing that you're permitted to have them do that kind of thing at your event, no matter what it is. And just make sure that everybody on your property that is a vendor is completely legit. And that means they have a business license and they have the proper insurance and they have all the things necessary to operate legally. Are you guys familiar with ADA? It's American Disabilities Act. You have to be compliant with the ADA codes and laws that pertain to anything with disabled people, all right? You have to be accessible to their needs, all right? And that goes with your restrooms, that goes with all your facilities. They have to be ADA accessible. Check the codes on that. Porta-johns, yes, you're gonna need porta-johns. They're gonna be required. You're also gonna need ADA compliant porta-johns, all right? These are not cheap, guys. So make sure you know what you're getting into. You're gonna have to have enough porta-johns to support how many people are gonna be at the event, regardless of if they have their own restrooms in their RVs or not, okay? The event has to be able to support the amount of people you're gonna have on its property. Insurance. Yes, you guys are going to be running a public event. You will be needing insurance for the event. And not only for yourself, not only for the people that are on your location site, but also those who are even vaguely involved with the event, such as property owners, and even in some cases, the city and county may have to be covered under your insurance. So they'll have to be additionally insured. So make sure you check into that and you know what you guys are getting into. So you're planning on having a whole bunch of van guys come out on your property and you're going to be responsible for them. I would suggest that you know what their rigs are all about. All right. You're going to be letting a bunch of rigs onto property and you don't have any idea what's going on in those rigs. What if there's a meth lab? Well, maybe. What if, the rig has a problem with, leaky gas or who knows what, propane leaks, and it creates a problem on your site? You know, it's not just people on the site, it's the rig as well. So those can potentially be a liability for you. Take that into consideration. I would think about where I'm holding this event and make sure that I have water, showers and amenities for my campers or for the event itself. You know, and that goes with having possibly a kitchen area or barbecue pit area, covered area for taking care of food preparation or any of that kind of stuff. In order for you guys to have a safe and successful event, you want to make sure that everybody who is on your property is staying to a code of conduct that you develop. And you develop this through your contracts and through your rules and regulations of the event. And this event does need rules and regulations, guys. So you're going to have to lay them down in order to make your occupancy comply with what you have to comply with. So whether that's vehicle standards as far as their RV goes, or consumption laws as far as alcohol goes, or as far as fires go on sites, really the list goes on. So you want to make sure that you have that list on a website way in advance of ever selling tickets. People need to understand there's going to be rules. Operational hours. Yes, that's right. You're going to have time limits, guys. There's things like noise ordinance laws, various other ordinance laws that don't often allow you to do these public events much after 10 or 11 o'clock at night. So you might have a curfew in some cases, or at least a noise regulation after hours that could be part of your planning, the bylaws and your rules. In most cases, when you're running a public event, you're going to have to pull some sort of a permit to run your generator. All right, guys? So keep that in mind when you have 20 RVs on site and half of them want to run a generator. All right? You want to make sure you know the laws in your area and the particular property you're operating on with the direct fire marshal on what the generator laws are. And if individuals might have to pull a permit in order to operate a generator, check into it, guys. So you have a lot of vehicles in one location and a lot of people doing cool stuff. What if there's a fire, or what if there's an emergency? How are the fire trucks going to get to your point of emergency? How are you going to get people out of a situation if there is an emergency? This is called a plan. You're going to have to come up with a point of egress plan, a fire escape plan of some sort, to make sure that if there is an emergency, you guys have a full grasp on how to handle it, all right? And not only do you people who are in charge have a full grasp on how to handle it, but each and every one of your employees understands how to handle an emergency and what the proper steps are to rectify a problem. So keep that in mind. Your employees. Yes, you'll have employees. Why? Because volunteers are not acceptable in a commercial business environment. You have to pay your employees. They have to be paid at least minimum wage. They have to be covered by the workman's comp laws and everything else that's required to have them legally be working on your property. If you have youngsters on your property doing any kind of service, there's child labor laws you have to be concerned with, all right? So keep this all in mind, and you guys will be able to get the event off in a proper fashion and not lose your ass. Well, guys, that's just a few of the things that you want to consider when you're putting together an event that you're talking about, if it's on the level of being a public event. And there's a lot more things to consider, and I'm just the tip of the iceberg. But if you are interested in learning how to do an event, hit me up. I'm not afraid to give you some information. I have a large background in it, and I kind of know the ropes a little bit, however they change all the time. So you got to keep up to date on what is legal in an occupancy or a public type of event. So anyways, that's about it for me, guys. Hope you're having a wonderful day. And I'm going to show you this right about now. Check it out.